Hi, everybody.
Take it away.
My name is Ivan Mladenovic, I run a couple different businesses in Miami that I'll tell you a little bit about. I started Preemo in 2009, originally as a computer repair. Well, actually, I'll back up one second here. I've been through a couple different types of businesses, but I always fixed computers as a kid. So it was sort of always my fallback whenever I needed a few bucks. I basically started fixing computers in my kitchen for friends of ours. It graduated into my dad's office about 6 months later with the vision of opening up an actual computer repair shop. I'm from Miami, Florida, and we have as many computer repair shops as we have realtors. So if you look around, what I did notice is that none of them were very well branded. A lot of them were very chop shoppy. We have this like kind of district in Miami where there's like, I'm not even kidding you, maybe 250 computer repair shops, and they're all right next to each other. And it gives you this like sketchy feel to it. We actually use a couple of the guys in there for like board level repairs, but in general, that business as a whole has been very seedy in Miami. So I saw an opportunity to create something that was a little bit more branded. So Preemo kind of started off as a computer repair shop that I did out of my kitchen. It grew into an IT consulting, a classical IT consulting company. We support about 350 businesses in South Florida now with a team of 8 technicians, one of which we started today. And out of that, I built Tech Bar. So this was sort of my vision when I started my business, was a highly visible retail location where we could do repairs of all different kinds. At the time I started, it was computer repairs, thanks to a brilliant young technician that actually was an intern that ended up being a technician that's now my head of mobile device repair. He brought in mobile device repairs first with iPhone 3G, I believe, was the first device we repaired, and all the way up. And needless to say, we used iFixit for anything and everything that we've repaired. So now we've gotten in more into tablet repairs. Obviously, that's something that we've seen a lot of prevalence in. We've seen different kinds of devices, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a second here. And lastly, kind of relevant to this group, is we started a nonprofit called Recycle IT. Basically, we partner with the Miami Heat, the Miami Dolphins, with the Downtown Development Authority, Cervera Real Estate, the related group. We basically created a campaign to push something that's called E-Rate, which basically is a matching grant from the U.S. government for donations to public schools in a given area. So Miami's E-Rate ended last February, I believe, if I remember correctly. And basically what we did is we partnered with two local recyclers who would give us, you know, a penny or whatever it was per pound of product that we donated. We then championed all the resources of all the sponsors to see if we can get as much product as we can. We had a donation day at a Heat game. We had a donation day at a Dolphins game. And we raised close to $250,000 in about 9 months for our Miami-Dade County Public Schools. Right now, it's sort of in limbo because we don't have E-Rate anymore, so the amount we're able to donate is not nearly as much based on the volume we're able to create. But E-Rate's actually coming back, so I don't know if it'll end up being some sort of campaign, but actually that's why I'm here. I also wanted to explore a little bit more about how to do this, because I think some of the projects you guys are doing with veterans and the disabled are really impressive, and I would like to get more into that. And I don't have a mustache usually. This is Team Preemo Stash and a brilliant Photoshop job by one of my friends. There's a campaign called Movember, if you guys have heard of it. Basically, the month of November is dedicated to men's health. If you want to go to movember.preemo.com, it'll be redirected to a page. You can donate to our campaign and to my mustache. So let's get busy. I'm going to share with you, I believe, 4 or 5 lessons that I have in mobile repair really quickly, and then I'll obviously open up to questions if you guys have any specific things. I would say that every one of my lessons applies to any kind of repairs that I do in my store, but I think because of the volume of mobile repairs that we've seen, this now is much more prevalent in my business. We have the one location that you saw, and we're actually opening 2 new locations right now, and we're looking at opening 20 stores in South Florida by the end of 2015. We also have a franchise model that we've built for this type of business as well. So the first thing is, don't buy cheap parts. Every lesson that you'll see I've learned from practice, and I've learned that if you actually skimp on anything, whether it be staff, your location, your brand, or in this case parts, it costs you that much more on the back end. We went through a slew of different things to find parts. We source our own parts right now. We buy some here and there in specific places, but we source most of our own parts. I used to actually work for a global purchasing company, so I used some contacts that I had overseas to be able to purchase very high quality parts. Another thing that we've also worked into the business model and applies more to later model iPhones and iPads is buying pre-assembled parts. So the more of the repair that you can get done before the part is installed, the faster the repair is being done. And it kind of caters to what Kyle said about, you know, being able to do a repair quickly. So our iPhone 5 repair with the pre-assembled part takes about 11 minutes now. It used to take about 58 minutes. So now we can, especially when someone comes in with an iPhone 5 or a 5S, we can get the device repaired very quickly for them. They're very happy. And what we've done actually for the whole, you know, 2 minute repair that we say an hour for, we do the, you know, under promise, over deliver concept. So we'll tell a customer, you know, typically we'll tell a customer it takes 45 minutes to an hour for a repair, and then we'll call them in 15 minutes and say, hey, we were able to fix your device faster, come pick it up, it's ready to go already. They appreciate that a lot. They refer us to their friends. It's good for business. Anything that you buy cheaply, you're gonna get that on the back end of your product. And why I really stress this is because re-repairing or warranty repairing a mobile device repair immediately destroys all your profit. So if you have to get it right the first time, and generally that means taking care, taking your time and so on, but it also means making sure that the part that you're replacing is gonna work for a certain period of time. We warranty all of our parts for 90 days. I would say because we're still a relatively small business, we warranty them for longer than that sometimes. But you'll find also, you know, for example, a repair we do at least once a week is iPhones that drop, the screen doesn't always break. The connector actually just comes loose. And that's probably the one repair that you can look like the biggest hero to anybody ever. It's literally a 1 minute repair. You'll just hand them their phone back and say, congratulations. We don't charge for that repair, actually. We just say, thank you. Make sure you come to us when actually something legitimate happens. So second lesson I'll have is invest in quality tools. Same thing with parts. If you're using cheap tools, you're gonna cost yourself repairs. That could be stripping a screw. That could be if you purchase a cheap anti-static mat or a cheap anti-static wristband, you might fry a device. But I can't stress it enough. If you get into the habit of warranty repairs in order to protect your brand, or God knows worse, actually fighting not to do a warranty repair, your business is going to suffer. And ultimately for me, it's more cost effective for me sometimes, you know, in the case of a warranty repair, just to re-replace the screen and create a happy customer than to have someone go out there and, you know, blast us on Yelp or something like that, which really punishingly hurts your business. We buy a lot of tools from iFixit. We've also invented some of our own tools that I've got a couple of them with that I'll share with you guys. But really, that's been a product of necessity. Sometimes a tool is not available. Sometimes a part is not available, and we'll have to also kind of rig some things. That's part of also having good technicians on board, which will be a lesson that I'll share in a minute here. Hire techs that care. So go ahead, I apologize.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. No, please. That's what we're here for. It's right there, Kyle. So it's funny you asked that. I can teach anybody to fix an iPhone. I can't teach you to be nice. So I hire technicians on personality. I hire someone who gives exceptional customer service. I hire somebody that comes dressed for an interview, that arrives on time. Because in general, you're gonna pay a mobile technician. In my stores, they'll start maybe at $8 or $10 an hour, and they'll work their way up to $15 or $20 an hour if they go into a manager's position. So for me, I really look for somebody. Number one, I want someone that wants to stay around. If it's just somebody that wants to get a summer job for 3 months, you know, maybe they'll come in, and we do have an internship program that we do as well, where we sort of know the expectation. I've hired 2 out of 3 interns that we've had in the 18 months we've had our store open. But I think that really you have to look for somebody who, exactly what it says, that cares about their repair. You really know that when you see the person do the first couple repairs. If you do an iPad repair, for example, on an iPad 2, as one that we see a lot, you'll see lint on the actual LCD when you put the screen on it. And a technician that cares will take, you know, a lint cloth and we'll wipe it off. We'll spray a little bit of air on it to make sure that when they're delivering a product to a client, that it looks new. I think arguably the most difficult thing to do on iPad repairs is bent corners. And we use a Dremel tool for that. And part of it is learning how to do it and having a little bit of finesse and handiness, handymanness. But part of it is also caring about it, not just, you know, banging it out just to make sure the screen fits. It's actually making it kind of look like it used to be, because ultimately, the better a repair you perform, the more the device looks like what they originally bought, the more they're going to like your business and then coming back to you. So I think if you hire, and it's funny how many people care, but I think that you really have to find someone that is really interested in the craft. Like there is a knack to it. I personally love to fix devices. I love taking things apart. I took apart every toy I ever had in my life. So to my mother's dismay. But I think that if you find someone who really is like that and who's more interested in putting the device back together and then really cares that the device at the end is the same device, that every screw is back where it should be. You know, a technician who cares, we do a lot of testing for technicians. So one of our tests is we'll take away a screw and we'll see if the technician will ask for that screw on the way back and making sure that he puts every screw back into the device. The lint one is a big one for me. I'll actually, like, in the middle of the repair, I'll tell him, you know, one of my guys will pull him away and someone will just, like, you know, brush like a sweater on it, and you'll just see like one or two pieces of lint. And the thing is, most people won't notice it. Most technicians won't notice it, but that one anal customer that will kill you and he'll make you repair it four times, you're gonna lose out on him tremendously, but also you're gonna create an angry client. And to me, that's, if there's anything that my business model is, it's creating happy clients. Because I want people to leave my store not just telling people that we're good, I want people to leave my store telling me that we're the best thing that ever happened to them, that I'm taking all my devices here. You know, Apple's average repair time on an iPhone 4, iPhone 4S is 24 to 48 hours. We repair them in less than 10 minutes. So I have, and the neighborhood that my store is in, Miami, and then also the neighborhood that we're opening our other stores are in, tend to be medium to high income areas, so people are willing to pay, not to wait. And so there's a great business opportunity there too. And this kind of piggybacks on that, you know, customer is number one. For me, I really don't question a customer that has a problem with a repair if it's, let's say, 60% warranted. I've had clients that have come in, you know, at the 4 month mark of a repair, and I'll warranty repair them. I have clients that have come back to me and said, you know, I flew to New York the day I repaired my phone, and I had to repair it at a shop in New York, and this is the bill, and I'll pay them for their bill. Because at the end of the day, we built a business basically on getting on good online reviews. We kind of capitalized on SEO when SEO was scammy, and you could kind of game the system. It's not really that way anymore. Fortunately, we're still up there on sites like Yelp and Google and Yahoo, and really, it's not even comparable. We have like 40 or so Yelp reviews. The next closest business has 3. So people just come to us because of the reputation that we've built. We augment our services as well. Like I said, we do have an IT consulting business, but out of our repair shop, we do Mac and PC repairs. Really the same thing as doing an iPhone or an iPad repair. I can definitely say that there's some specialization. So I have a technician that specializes in doing Mac repairs. We have a technician that's sort of like a gopher and mainly does PC repairs, but does everything. And then we have a mobile repair technician in our stores. Obviously iPhone and iPad repair, on-site services, by far the most profitable thing you could do. Being able to send someone on site. Obviously it costs you a technician during the time that you're out, but something that you can do. Small business IT support and IT consulting services. And this is where you can get me if you have any questions. We're actively like seeking franchisees for our business, and we've got a pretty good brand out there. So if you have any questions, let me know.
Any questions, Ryan?
Yeah, I was just kind of wondering, where do you source your parts from? I don't know if that's something proprietary.
It's not proprietary. There are specific suppliers that we've used. So part of what I did in global sourcing was, I would fly to China and I would source parts. So the company that I worked for primarily sourced hospitality parts. And I would basically, if you go to the Wynn Hotel in Las Vegas, everything that you touch in the Wynn Hotel was sourced from our company. And basically they said, we'd like to buy this West Elm desk, but we don't want to buy it from West Elm. And I would go to China and I would see if I could find that West Elm desk. And ultimately it became developing relationships with factories, flying to about four or five different countries, figuring things out and kind of creating my own supply chain. Part of it is the relationship with the supplier. That is without question what I've found to be the most difficult thing to create, because there's an obvious language barrier and there's obviously some risk. So have I been burned by suppliers? No doubt about it. And I tend to try, so for example, there's like three or four suppliers in the United States. And so if I need 1, 2, 5, 10 of a product, I'll always buy it locally. I'll always pay with PayPal, so I know that I have some reassurance. If you buy overseas and you're spending, $15,000, $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 on product, you probably do a wire transfer because you get slammed with a PayPal fee. But you might buy from that supplier maybe at a couple thousand dollar mark on PayPal first, develop a relationship, then buy a little bit more, and then buy a little bit more. And for me, it turned out to be 3 out of 50 people that I've worked with that have been legitimate suppliers.
Yeah, I know. It's like I get emails and random stuff all the time from people trying to sell me their screens or that, and it's just so hard to decide who's going to be the most reliable. And I think another thing too, I guess maybe you can expand on it too, is a lot of times the prices fluctuate. So I don't know how often do you update your pricing too, would be maybe a good question.
So Miami is a very competitive pricing city in that sense, especially because there's a bunch of shyster computer repair shops.
So
I generally keep my prices with my competitors. That's where my price is. We did iPhone 5 repairs at $189. Apple came out and said, we're going to do them for $149. That same day, I dropped my price down to $129. And I had 100 customers in my door within the next week. My competitors now dropped to $129. And so now we're all in the same place. Now my next move would be to go back to my distributor and say, can you give me this for like $5-$8 less? So I'm going to do $119 now. And again, I'm still the lowest guy in town. I have a reasonable profit on the repair because iPhone 5 repairs tend to be, they are more profitable than doing iPhone 4 and 4S repairs. So, you have to be really careful. If I were to give you advice, especially if you're starting out a business or getting into this first, I would buy everything locally. I'd buy from an iFixit. I would buy from a local supplier that you can Better Business Bureau. You can get some sort of data on them to find the part right away. But you also have to consider the fact that you have to be competitive in whatever market you're in. If you're the only repair guy in your neighborhood, charge whatever you want, because it's always going to be cheaper than going and buying a new phone at the Apple store. So I guess one thing that I didn't address, now that I'm hearing myself say it a couple of times, we stray away from repairing certain devices as well, because it hasn't become cost effective yet. So part of that goes into parts sourcing and looking at other devices to repair. Obviously we don't repair BlackBerry, we repair some Android devices, but we stick to iPhone and iPad and it tends to be just fine for us.
Sorry, you mentioned...
Hang on just a second. Sorry. And I will also say that we have a reseller program, so the prices that you see on the iFixit website are not the prices that we would give you guys. So you can email us and get on our reseller program and we'll give you different prices.
So you mentioned that you've got one standard price point. It says all repairs are $129.
No. Different repairs cost differently. In general, it's by model. Of that specific device, and we try to restrict part of what Kyle was saying. 5,000 mobile devices, definitely not keeping 5,000 devices worth of parts in stock. I mean, if you look at an iPhone 4S, you probably have got, 40, 50 replaceable parts. First of all, keeping all those parts, you may never use certain parts, but they're cost effective enough that you can buy five of each and you've started your business. The trick is, if you start getting into multiple device repairs, it starts becoming more and more expensive in terms of what you need to stock in order to deliver that, while you wait promise. But that's why we stick to iPhone and iPad in general. We have repaired certain other devices. I've repaired, I can't remember. We've repaired some Asus tablets. We've repaired Galaxy S4s and S3s, to my dismay. Still not very cost effective. And I say that not because they're not repairable devices. Every device is repairable, and iFixit's tech. I mean, my guys learn exactly the way your guys do. Hi, welcome to Preemo. Here's an iPhone 4. Here's a repaired guide. Good luck. Like, and really that you start, that's part of the gauge of who the technician is can they learn by themselves? For me, I'm looking, number one, at the volume of repairs that we're getting of a specific device, and I might get, you know, one S4 for every 50 iPhones that I get. Like, it's not even close. And there are quite a lot of S3s and S4s in Miami in terms of devices, but those people are also looking for repairs, are looking for a more cost-effective repair, and that's not the person I'm looking for. I'm looking for somebody that's iPhone is the most important thing in the world for them, and they're not willing to sit and wait for a Genius bar appointment to get it replaced. They're willing to pay me the $129, they're going to get it done quickly, they're going to get a great warranty on it, they're going to get great service, and they turn it around.
Okay, thank you.
Is there a good business with printers?
No.
Well, hang on, was it you?
No, that's my business.
Yeah, it's you, so why don't you answer that?
That's the business.
And it helps all the time to establish our credibility.
Yeah.
Because there's so many shysters in my business. So we had to end up repairing the many office machines that we supplied cartridges for in order to establish our credibility. It's not a big profit. We make probably 5% of my income as printer repair.
I can further answer that. I actually do that more on the IT. So we started supplying cartridges to our IT clients. It became a 15% increase in overall revenue for us. So printer cartridges were wonderful because they were buying them anyway. And they, especially with IT clients, when you convert someone to be your IT client, you have essentially married them, because as your IT guy, I know more about you than your banker does or anybody else, and probably as much as your wife does. So I think, or husband, you know, so I think that but actually repairing printers themselves, I've actually found that I can show a customer it is less expensive for them to replace the printer, especially when you're in small business. You're not dealing with a, you know, $5,000-$10,000 printer. You might be dealing with a couple $100 printer. Another opportunity that we have with printers is we work very closely with a Xerox, you know, multifunction device type of leasing company, and they kick us referrals, and we kick them referrals, and we both kick each other referral fees for jobs closed. So that's, you know, it's one of those, like, do what you're the best at and refer the rest. So printers is not something that we do, and people ask that also. LCD monitors, like repair of actual, not laptop monitors, but actual computer monitors, we wouldn't do something like that. It's just not cost effective.
We've gotten a number of LCD monitors with bad capacitors, and we'll fix it. We haven't done it like as a business, but we've repaired them that we use in the office, and it's worked pretty well.
Yeah, very, very different thing is what we repair for our own egos, and we do a lot of that. One thing that we haven't gotten into, and I'm still trying to figure out how to make a great business out of it, is gaming system repair. In Miami, it tends to be that the devices are replaced. One of my big competitors does a lot of those repairs, and I'm convinced there's a better business than I see in it. So that's something that I've been exploring for next year.
Well, so the gaming business is an interesting opportunity right now, because you've got, 50 million PS3s and Xbox 360s that are out there that people are going to be getting rid of.
Right.
And if you can figure out a way to collect those, refurbish them, and then resell them around the world, export them, I would imagine most of the market for those is exported. It could be really
similar. I think there's a biz. So I can definitely intake devices. If you told me, I would pay a client, $20, $30, $50 for the iPhone that's broken or water damaged that absolutely is defunct now, I would do that all day long. I still haven't found, and maybe I hope to find here, someone who will broker that. Well, basically, I would say, look, I have 90 Xboxes, I've got 300 iPhones. I mean, we sell a really great business that is completely under the radar is selling broken iPhone screens. That is our happy hour money for about 6 months every time we do a sale. It's just, I don't even care what they're doing with them.
So people are buying, they'll buy
the
LCD. Broken iPhone screens. So you've got the screen, you got the display, and it's glued to the front glass.
Mm-hmm.
And they are separating the glass from the screen. And this isn't just iPhone, this is any tablet.
Right.
Any mobile device where you've got the glass fused to the LCD. They're separating the glass using, I mean, there's some pretty cool machines for using very thin wires to slice the adhesive between the glass and the LCD, and then they're just replacing the glass, preserving the LCD, and then reselling them. And then, I mean, that's the source of some of the parts that we get. And this is part of why your parts supply chain can be so unreliable,
right?
Is because you've got people cobbling together parts from all sorts of different sources. So it might be an original OEM LCD with a, you know, cheap aftermarket digitizer that they glued on there.
That's when you see like a supplier with like, you know, A grade, B grade, C grade, and then an OEM grade, and there is a huge difference between A, B, and C.
The other thing is OEM grade does not mean OEM.
Right.
It just means the best that we can.
The best that we can give you. Yeah. Yeah. You should always be buying. The difference in price is usually $5. So you think, oh my God, you know, on this repair I might be making $30 on the repair. So to make $35 is a massive increase in the value of the repair. But if that repair doesn't work, and the customer comes back and you have to re-replace that screen, now you're out, you know, negative 200%. So you just it's not worth it. It's absolutely not worth it. The difference is expectations to the client. So on the mobile and tablet side, and if you split those two up, I'll take a tablet over a mobile phone all day long. The repairs tend to be easier. I don't want to say easier. The repairs tend to be about the similar difficulty, but there's more profit in a tablet because people just think it's bigger and more difficult for some reason. So we charge more. When you look at PC and Mac repairs, especially Mac repairs, which we do, we probably repair, I think our store does about 350 devices a month right now. And so if you look at that side, first of all, there's more variables in the parts. So I don't stock very many parts except like certain hard drives, RAM, things like that. There's also expectations to the client. So one thing you have to know very well on the PC side, on the computer side, and you do also on the mobile device repair side, but I think it tends to be more critical, is data recovery and being able to pull off someone's information. Because in general, if you know how to back up an iPhone, it doesn't matter if you lose their contacts because you can restore them, but if you lose pictures of their kid, you're dead. So I think that, you know, knowing how to, you know, there's a really cool website that we use called TechNibble. It's TechNibble. It's a guy from like, I think it's like from Australia or something like that. And he's got a blog and he puts a bunch of computer repair tools on there. And we get a ton of advice from him as well. It's very similar. It's got a forum. It's not nearly as developed, but there's some really cool products that he offers as far as software products for like data recovery backup. But it's a different business. They're definitely two very different technicians. My Mac guy actually struggles with iPhone repair. The iPhone repair guy refuses to fix computers, just because they're very different. It tends to, like, mobile repair tends to be a more like meticulous personality thing where you're like sitting, you're just kind of zoned in, whereas my PC tech fixes six computers at the same time. Profitability wise, I would probably say computer repair is a little bit more profitable
per item, but
my volume of mobile phones is probably twice that of computers. So at the end, we're almost 50-50 in that respect. If you can add on-site services, so we've gotten to the point where we have enough on-site services, we have a full-time tech in our tech bar that does on-site services, that's fantastic. We actually have built an agreement now with two law firms in downtown Miami where we basically send a technician once a quarter. A technician sits in their conference room and will repair anything they have in the office, iPhones, iPads, and things like that. And we'll get, you know, 20, 30 repairs, because these are, you know, 500-600 person law firms. We'll get 20, 30 devices, and they know that. Now we're trying to create a pickup and delivery system for that as well.
It's a really good mechanism, providing an in-house Genius Bar type service. Okay, last question, and then we're going to head to the break.
Stuff that's not repairable, percentage-wise.
A lot. Non-repairable in terms of because it's a phone that we won't repair, or
phone you won't repair, phone that's water damaged, phone that's not
repairable. I'll give you one pointer on water damage. There's a product that so the mayor of South Miami, where our store is also a professor at FIU. He told us about a product that's called DryRite, D-R-I-R-I-T-E. It's a laboratory grade. I'm not going to come up with the word right now. It's the same thing as those little silica packets that you get in clothes, except it's 10 times stronger. If you can convince your customer that, called, hey, I just dropped my phone in the water, tell them to come right away. It works about 50% of the time. So water damage has been, and we charge a lot for water damage because those tend to be very difficult repairs. But I would say maybe, I don't have a statistic to be honest with you. We do turn down maybe 1 to 2 people a day for repairs that we don't do. We have a lot of people that come in that are trying to repair like a Metro PCS phone or like a flip. I haven't figured out a model of what to do with them. I get so much e-waste that I'm also hoping here to figure out what to do with it so that maybe I could profit from it. Right now, I give it away. We basically just need it out of our store. We do keep some products. Yeah, so we keep some products, for example, like any type of a. So if we get a water-damaged MacBook Pro, we'll keep the MacBook Pro because the display is perfectly fine and the display can be used on a different screen. We'll offer that next client, look, we can give you a brand new display and it will cost you this much, or we can give you a refurb off one of the ones in the back. I don't think I've ever had a problem with one of those refurb displays. So we do things like that, but I haven't figured out a great business model for what to do with what's left. But we get a pickup once a week, probably about 30 to 50 computers that disappear out of our store. I don't know where they go, but they're all computers that I would have no interest in. I don't even know anything about that, to be totally frank with you. I hope to learn. I'm also an attendee here.
I'm in tune with that, but there's a big market out there for people not to do the right things.
And the whole rest of the conference will address that. So
that's why I'm so excited.
But I think this is fantastic. This is a really good deep dive into some of the issues that you run into with mobile device repair. We're going to take a 10-minute break. And then we're going to come back and we're going to go into more computer refurbishment and repairs.